Hi there, I'm David, and today we're going to talk about Pigouvian Tax and Pigouvian Subsidy. Are you ready? Well, too bad. Let's get started. Now, I'd like to kick us off with letting you know that you can relax, calm down. It's all right if you didn't understand this topic in your lecture. It's something that can be explained in a way that doesn't necessarily make sense, such as when it comes to deadweight loss. And a lot of students get a little bit confused as to why deadweight loss isn't a factor when it comes to both systems. We've all had that situation where we ask the teacher or professor, well, why is that the answer? And they say, because. Why? Because. It's all right, it's not necessarily your fault, and it's not necessarily your issue if you didn't understand it to begin with. Sometimes things are a little bit more complicated than they need to be. Deadweight loss, for those that don't know, is an excessive burden where economic efficiency is lost when socially optimal quantity is not produced. And when it comes to the Pigouvian tax and Pigouvian subsidies, we can avoid and mitigate that altogether. So let's get started and talk about these two systems and how they work and how they increase market efficiency. Pigouvian subsidies and Pigouvian taxes, they come from someone named Arthur Cecil Pigou. Now, I want to say it in a more professional way for him, but I just can't. And I mean him no disrespect, but Mr. Pigou has one of the best last names that I have ever come across. So, Arthur had come up with a way to overcome both social costs of different things, such as pollution from manufacturing, and how to increase the demand for a good or service such as education. First, we'll take a look at Pigouvian subsidies and see how we can improve a system where it helps society, but the demand over time reduces. And we'll talk about education here, just to make this kind of simple to grasp. So, if you think about it, education is one of the driving forces for the economy. Without education, the people cannot work in specialized professions. But what happens when everybody goes through the education system is that the demand ends up becoming low because everybody's already gone through the educational system. And there are those that may not want to go to a university, for example, maybe a state university, a college, some community college in this factor. So imagine that the social value is this line here, but what's happening is that the demand is down here for a community college. Nobody really wants to go because, you know, it's a little bit, you know, more expensive than they'd like, and the value just isn't really there for them. So how can we improve this? Well, first of all, let's take a look at a few figures that are here on this chart so that we understand it. This is the market price here, and this is the efficient price here. This is our original curve or our original demand line, and this is the quantity of the market and the quantity in efficiency. Here, anything in between would be deadweight loss, but our result, again, won't end in that. And we have an efficient equilibrium over here and the market equilibrium here. This line, again, is our social value. This is the supply of the private cost. Over here, we have the social value difference between the demand and the social value. And down here, we have the private cost for the institution to provide the service. Now, over here, we have an underuse issue, and the external benefit is here. Now, external benefit, now that we've talked about this chart, now there could be external damages or costs, and there can be external benefits. So negative influences, negative externalities, and positive externalities. It's not always just a negative externality, such as a fishing company. If you take a look at the other video, which you could find up here. So you take a look at a farm of fauna within a bay, but there's a fishing company that needs to drive through that bay and it causes damage to the fauna that that company is trying to sell. Or, you know, maybe different fish hatcheries or something like that that they have netted off. Doesn't really matter, but in this case they're causing damage as they go through. So they come to a compromise because there is a negative externality affecting one organization, and the other company isn't really compensating or paying for it. So That would be a negative, but we also have positives. And like I said, school here, or university, such as a community college, can be a driving force to overcome a number of challenges within an economy. There are four major types of unemployment, and one of which is a big factor that comes into play when there are not enough skilled professionals for filling the jobs that are required, which is actually something that we are facing right now in 2021. So when a government, and yes, it would be the government in this case, gives a subsidy to a community college, you are thereby driving up demand by increasing not only the quality of the good or service, but also by increasing the likelihood that individuals would attend to that community college or would be interested in that good or service. Generally speaking, it reduces the price, but in this case here, we end up with a slight increase. It's not always a perfect situation or a perfect solution, but even with that increase in price to the consumer, to the end user, it still has much more value to them, and therefore they partake in it. And next up, we have the Pigouvian Tax. Pigouvian Tax. The Pigouvian Tax comes into play when there is a negative externality, such as manufacturing causing a lot of pollution, which is causing harm to the local population within the general vicinity. So, for example, maybe they need to go to the doctor more often, or they need to buy masks, such as in certain cities in the East. So in this case, there would need to be a payout from this company to compensate for what they are doing, or to reduce the likelihood of them doing it as much. So what we have here is our supply, the private cost supply, and our social cost supply. Of course, we want the market to become equal, and we don't want there to be an issue for our people, but no matter what we do, there's always going to be a negative consequence for production of various goods, whether it be one way or another, and the company isn't necessarily going to think about that or factor it into their costs. And that's where the tax comes into play. By increasing the amount that they need to produce per unit, to increase the price per unit via taxation causes there to be a lower supply that is created. So they're not going to want to sell as much, if you would, because they can't really produce as much without raising the price, which then causes an equilibrium between both supply and demand. And we end up with an efficient price, which might be higher per unit, but then because demand is now lower, we have an equilibrium. So this is an efficient equilibrium here, and we have a market equilibrium here. The market equilibrium does not take into consideration the cost on the population around this factory. However, the efficient equilibrium does. Anything between here is a deadweight loss. Now, between here and here is the external cost. So if you look at this chart and it's a little bit confusing, don't worry. Just understand that between these two lines is the external cost. Additionally, when you were looking at these two lines here on your test or whatever you're doing, maybe an exam or some project, mark down social cost, which is from here to here, from market equilibrium up to the social cost, and the private value. So the private value is for the company. We have overuse of the product here at the market equilibrium, but we end up with an efficient use of the product here. Don't forget to subscribe, check out other videos, like, leave a comment with any questions, or whatever you have to say. We look forward to reading them, and hit that bell for notifications in the future. We'll see you next time.